of the local militia and under heavy protection. We were then taken to the village school, which we were told had been bombed out by guerrillas. On our way back, we stopped at a monthly meeting of tribal leaders. A government spokesman was assuring them it was safe to plant their fields and that the government was getting the upper hand with the rebels. As early as a year ago, there had been heavy fighting in this area. Once more, Malang was brought forward as a symbol of the government's success and to spread the message that what the rebels were doing was against Islam. Listening in unobtrusively were Soviet soldiers atop a personnel carrier. The Soviets keep a low profile wherever they go, especially in the capital city of Kabul. Whether Russian or Afghan, the military seems to disappear on Fridays. That's when peasants come in from the countryside for the Muslim Sabbath. The present Marxist government appears to be doing everything it can to dispel the notion that it stands for godless communism, or that it rejects the old Islamic values. At this moment, however, many Western observers feel that the Afghan government does not have a broad base of support, that it would fall if the Soviets pulled out. And there are those who feel the Soviets would like to find a dignified way of disengaging themselves from what some call a Russian Vietnam. This is Paul Fitzgerald for Nightline.
Throughout the 1980s, as American and Saudi Arabian aid increased, the military government of Pakistan's Zia-ul-Haq grew more extreme in its support for Islamization and radicalizing the tribal areas, following the Soviet pullout in 1989 and the American refusal to help establish a broad-based Afghan government. Rebel groups led by Gulbuddin Hekmatyar and Ahmad Shah Massoud continued to battle for control, first with the remnants of the Marxist Afghan government and then with each other. It was Hekmatyar's failure to secure control of Afghanistan that led to the next major development in the Afghan war, the Taliban. Disguised as an indigenous Afghan movement as a cover for Pakistan's military involvement, the Taliban would appear to rise from nowhere. Not really. Pakistan's president, Asif Ali Zardari, now admits the Taliban was a creation of Pakistan's military intelligence, the ISI, and the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency. On the heels of Pakistan's failure to control Afghanistan through Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, the Taliban represented an entirely new and alien form of Islam. Cobbled together from strains of the Saudi Wahhabi sect and the 19th century Puritan Deobandi school, throughout the 1990s, their growing control over Afghanistan played directly into Pakistan's military plans and its need to maintain Afghanistan as a strategic military asset in its ongoing conflict with India. Known for their unusual practice of a hybridized and severe Sharia law, for their overt revulsion and abuse of women, and their alliance with Osama bin Laden, the Taliban were courted by certain U.S. government representatives throughout the 1990s. Not until the 1998 U.S. Embassy bombings in East Africa and the bombing of the USS Cole in 2000 did their support for bin Laden and his Arab al-Qaeda fighters become a liability.
Pakistan played a very key role. Pakistan was a frontline state during the battle against the Soviet occupation. Pakistan and many other countries also felt threatened that perhaps with the communist superpower on their borders, Pakistan could be the next domino to fall. So Pakistan did join the resistance against the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan.
But rebuilding Afghanistan has been hampered from the start by the West's continued tolerance for warlordism at the expense of the civil society that existed before the war. Prior to the Marxist coup that put Afghanistan at ground zero in the Cold War, Afghanistan had experienced a slow but steady progress towards power sharing and democratization. Women's rights, including the right to vote, had been granted in the 1920s, and though rural villages maintained traditional customs, Afghanistan's cities witnessed a rapid growth that fueled demands for modernization and broad social change. The extremism fostered by the war against the Soviets was as much a war against this social change as it was against the communist state apparatus. And as the war ground down the countryside, 100 years of progressive reforms went with it. Now Afghanistan must be taken back to the basics, but for many in the West who know only of the war against the Russians, conveying a complete picture of the Afghanistan that was lost is a frustrating exercise. 20 years ago, when Russian uniforms graced the streets of Kabul instead of American, Afghanistan loomed large on the radar. But the Cold War images that kept America enthralled disguised Afghanistan's long struggle to become a modern nation. Slowly emerging over centuries with an economy largely supported by the central government, the war in Afghanistan crippled an economy already devastated by years of drought and low-intensity warfare waged over the border from Pakistan. Aimed first at schools that educated women, the radical assault on all things modern pitted family member against family member, and over a series of years wore down the fragile state of ethnic tolerance that had been established over centuries by the reigning dynasty. As radical Islamic warlords replaced tribal chieftains and mullahs as regional leaders, Afghanistan returned to a state not known since the days of Genghis Khan, and with the aid of numerous outside supporters, remained that way until the American bombing campaign drove the Taliban from the scene.
Following the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan in 2001, Al-Qaeda and the Taliban fled over the Durand Line to Pakistan and found safe haven. After abandoning its Afghan war to fight in Iraq in 2003, the U.S. paid Pakistan $15 billion to kill or capture Al-Qaeda leaders and stop Taliban infiltration back over the Durand Line. But instead of fighting the Taliban, Pakistan's President Pervez Musharraf bolstered the Taliban's networks while diverting billions to Pakistan's perpetual military preparations for war with India. The Obama administration's decision to engage Pakistan on an equal footing with Afghanistan emerged only after Washington finally accepted that Pakistan's ISI was aiding the Taliban in their cross-border war with US and NATO forces, and that Pakistan was on the verge of caving in to Taliban extremism. On March 27, 2009, the administration made the AFPAC plan public. The five-point plan reflected the importance of stabilizing both Afghanistan and Pakistan by 1. Disrupting terrorist networks in Afghanistan and Pakistan to degrade any ability they have to plan and launch international terrorist attacks. 2. Promoting a more accountable and effective government in Afghanistan that serves the Afghan people and can eventually function, especially regarding internal security, with limited international support. 3. Developing self-reliant Afghan security forces that can lead the counterinsurgency and counterterrorism fight with reduced U.S. assistance. 4. Assisting efforts to enhance civilian control and stable constitutional government in Pakistan and a vibrant economy that provides opportunity for the people of Pakistan. 5. Involving the international community to assist in addressing these objectives for Afghanistan and Pakistan with an important leadership role for the United Nations. Then in April, the Council on Foreign Relations' Daniel Markey recommended an alternative idea, labeling the plan from AFPAC to PAC-AF. Markey shifted the entire focus away from helping Afghanistan to helping Pakistan continue what it had been doing for the previous 8 years under the Bush administration, except more so. Markey proposed that in addition to downsizing the burden on the United States, the responsibility for Afghanistan should be offloaded to other donors or shifted away from Afghanistan altogether and back towards Pakistan. U.S. efforts should be focused on winning the trust of Pakistan's military, its intelligence and civilian institutions, and not wasted on expanding U.S. military, diplomatic, and aid assistance to Afghanistan. Instead of fixing a failed Afghan policy, Markey's thinking reflected Washington's proclivity to favor Pakistan. Washington's policy had been to look the other way while Pakistan developed its nuclear arsenal in the 1970s and to grant Pakistan's military carte blanche in supporting terror groups in the 1980s and 90s that created Al-Qaeda and the Taliban and to ignore these terror groups as they grew. The Bush administration had even looked the other way when these terror groups fled Afghanistan following 9/11 and ignored their resurgence with the help of Pakistan's military government. Today, this policy continues with a regular promotional campaign aimed at negotiating so-called moderate Taliban into the Afghan government. But can there really be such a thing as moderate Taliban? Or is that simply another invention of a foreign policy establishment bent on meeting the needs of a variety of special interests at the expense of the Afghan and Pakistani people? The Taliban were created by Pakistani ISI to force a Pakistani-friendly government on Afghanistan. The Pakistan lobby, which included Charlie Wilson, has been at work on an Islamist agenda since 1973. A recent BBC poll of Afghans revealed that only 6% want the Taliban back. Yet Washington still promotes this as a solution to a worsening military and political situation. An op-ed, Boston Globe, by U.S. Representative Stephen F. Lynch from Massachusetts, titled "The Price of Appeasing the Taliban," framed the true nature of the ongoing game being played on the Afghan people. The Taliban is a violent and oppressive regime that has given support to Al-Qaeda and employed brutality against the general population, especially against women. The Taliban has massacred ethnic minority civilians and used rape as a tool of intimidation. It has burnt hundreds of schools to prevent the education of girls. It has stormed schools that teach girls and has beheaded teachers as horrified children watched. I recently met with female members of the Afghan parliament who were angry with Karzai, who had proposed the Taliban appeasement plan in London without getting the input of women in parliament. They said they fear for the women of Afghanistan, their basic rights of free speech, their freedom of travel, freedom of association, and voting rights. These women said that they respect the United States not merely for its economic success or its military power, but for upholding individual rights for all of its citizens. This, they said, is the intoxicating idea of America. End of quote. As a member of the House Subcommittee on National Security and Foreign Relations, Representative Lynch has stated the facts about the Taliban with a clarity rarely heard in Washington. In fact, according to counterterrorism expert Andrew Exum of the Center for the New American Security, Washington's war in Afghanistan is only about military tactics and not about political strategy at all. According to Exum, quote, "America's counterinsurgency war in Afghanistan has focused more on waging war at the operational and tactical level at the expense of the strategic and political levels. As a consequence, the United States and its allies have not thought rigorously enough about how U.S. and allied interests might not align with those of the Afghan government." Exum uses John Paul Vann's description of the Vietnam War to illustrate that without developing a political and economic strategy in a, quote, political war, no amount of indiscriminate killing, especially from the air, can hope to achieve anything but failure. The U.S. faces the ultimate test as it crosses the zero line and becomes more embroiled in Afghanistan and Pakistan's internal politics. Since World War II, the U.S. has invested its political will in building an unquestioned military superiority. But despite that superiority, the one weapon it appears to need to fulfill its AFPAC policy is the one it now does not have: the political and diplomatic skill necessary to bring the war to a successful conclusion for the Afghan and Pakistani people. In crossing zero, the United States has crossed a threshold where its capacity for violence undermines its own capacity to achieve victory. The turning point, where the purpose of the force it has created has reached its own undoing. It is no longer an issue of the politics of left versus right or conservative versus liberal. It is not even an issue of good versus evil. It is simply the point where war does more harm than good, where it destroys what it claims to protect, and where it is neither just nor unjust, but amounts to nothing more than zero. Afghanistan has given us a mirror in which to understand this truth about ourselves and to see what we have become as a nation and a democracy. Our future will depend on whether we can accept the challenges that it presents.